Hi everyone, and thank you for joining me for Healthytarian Living. On this episode, I am pleased to announce Dr. Gabriel Cousens is joining me as the featured guest. Dr. Cousens, hello and welcome.
Thank you. I'm very happy to be on your program again. It's a delight.
It's wonderful to have you.
Good, and thank you for the good work you're doing in making this available to the public.
Oh, thank you so much. And again, a pleasure to have you on again, as almost a year ago we connected on the EBTV network to talk specifically at that time about your new book, Conscious Parenting. And for anybody who may have missed that or was not aware about that show, there's a link available underneath this video as well. And today we are going to be focusing all about the foundational teaching that you share and provide with people now for decades when it comes to optimal nutrition. And so for anybody who may be new to your work, I will share with the audience, Dr. Gabriel Cousens is the author of 13 internationally acclaimed books, including Conscious Eating and Spiritual Nutrition. He is known worldwide as a spiritual teacher and the leading expert in raw, live, plant-source nutrition, and functions as a holistic physician, psychiatrist, family therapist, and cutting-edge researcher on healing diabetes naturally. Dr. Cousens is also the founder and director of the Tree of Life Foundation, Tree of Life Center US, and Cousins School of Holistic Wellness. And, you know, I've been blessed to come across your work many, many years ago now. And part of what Healthytarian Living, what these episodes, what this lifestyle really is all about, is not just about healthy eating, but about healthy living for the mind, body, and spirit. And one of the big reasons why I resonate so much with your work and want to also share it with our audience as well. And so given your many, many years of work, whether it's, again, for the body, for the mind, for the spirit, given all of your experience up to date, what do you share is the optimal diet for humans?
The optimum diet is a variable. A diet must also fit your constitution. The recent research in the field called nutrigenomics shows that on chromosome 19, that the exact amount of carbohydrate and fat and protein are kind of laid out. Generally speaking, about 30% of the population needs a lower protein, higher complex carbohydrate diet, and a little bit higher fat diet. And then 70% need a higher protein, higher fat, and lower complex carbohydrate diet. So that's just one level. With age, what you need changes. Obviously, growing kids need a little bit more, but let's look at it from the other end. Research on middle-aged men, 45 to 60, roughly speaking, shows that if they have an excess of protein, particularly animal protein, they double their rate of mortality and quadruple the rate of cancer. But after 65, the men, they didn't do the research on women, so I can't, you know, it's probably the same for both, okay? I'm almost sure it is. They actually needed more protein to be an optimal physical, emotional, mental health. Now, that's really interesting. Now, but even talking about the topic of protein, what's more, what's less, there's a pathway called the mTOR, M, capital T, capital O, capital R. And it basically says that you need to be between 35 and 70 grams of protein. So high protein at 70 grams may be low if you're doing a caveman diet. You see what I mean? But in reality, there's our range. So we need to stay within that range. So what does that look like? If somebody is what we call a fast oxidizer, meaning you're in that 70 that needs a higher protein, on a vegan live food diet, some of them may need a tablespoon to 2 tablespoons, never more than that, per meal of some sort of protein concentrate, spirulina, chlorella, blue green algae, something like that. So there's a range that in our complex world we can do that. Okay, so it has to be individualized to not only your constitution, but the stage of life that you were in. Now, these are very important considerations. I'm going to go back another way, just to give you an idea. So they're finding that children who go start school a little bit on the early side, they have twice as much diagnosis of ADHD. Mm-hmm. If you wait 1 year, what will seem abnormal, they no longer have as a problem because it's a developmental issue. So at both ends of the spectrum, we have to be very, very thoughtful about what's going on. You know, at the short end, you don't want to be having kids go on medication for ADHD, which alters your brain structure and brain function and makes you more susceptible to cocaine addiction later, because there are these things like Adderall and Ritalin are long-acting cocaine-like substances. So, but the point I'm making is different. So you take a kid who's a younger kid in school, you diagnose him with ADHD and put on medication, you're doing a huge disservice. Wait a year and see if they're really actually quite normal. So these are very important considerations when we say, well, what's your optimal diet? So individualize to your constitution. Now, in my experience, in the long term, okay, 95 to 100% LIFO diet is the Olympic diet. But what I've observed is if people do 80% live food for 2 years, they have many of the, or most of the health benefits that people were immediately on 100% LIFO diet. So that's actually a very important thing to consider. Sustainability is important. So what I tell people, go one step at a time in making this transition. You're more likely to be successful, and pick a step that you can succeed with. The success is very, very powerful that way. So I try to move people to at least 80% in a sustainable way where there isn't a rebound.
Right. And so when you're sharing here about the constitution of nutrients like carbohydrates, protein, and fats, and an emphasis, of course, on live foods, one of the other foundational aspects to your work and what you teach and share for optimal health, healing, prevention is that the foods are plant-based and really an emphasis on vegan or veganic food. Can you share with us why this is important, that if somebody does need higher protein or lower protein or higher fat or so, that it's coming from plant foods as opposed to animal foods?
There's a lot of reasons for that. It's a good question. But let's just be simple, okay? Animal foods are higher on the food chain. I believe it was John Robbins in one of his books mentioned that 96% of the pesticides and herbicides are really gotten from animal foods. Maybe animal foods are somewhere between 50 and 30 times higher in pesticides, herbicides, and radiation. I'm going to have the radiation. That's a big issue today. So by eating lower on the food chain, you immediately are, you know, have a significant protection. That's actually quite important, okay? The other thing about lower on the food chain has to do with animal protein actually tends to make you insulin resistant. So it tends to contribute to diabetes. Basically, animal protein increases your rate of diabetes by 35 to 50%. It increases your rate of cancer. There's a study at Harvard with 121,000 people, and it showed if you eat like a deck of card size of meat per day, you really increase your mortality rate by 20%, your heart disease by 19 to 21%, cancer by 13%. There's another study at Oxford with 44,000 people, and they basically said if you're eating, again, decacard size of meat a day, you're increasing your rate of heart disease, heart attack by 32%. So there's a significant health advantage by eating lower on the food chain. And now with the radiation, pesticides, and herbicides, and we look at fertility, vegans are going to be more fertile because they're having less toxins to the sperm and ovum. That's actually a pretty big deal. So that's just one part. Now, what about why else eat lower in food chain? Well, spiritually, the soul is in the blood. So when you're not taking blood, you're not taking the animalistic energies. That's one level. And pretty much all the traditions, spiritual traditions, but one, talk about the spilling of blood. And therefore, more refined thinking, and you're not taking in animalistic kind of tendencies. So most are vegan. In India, the rishis had a little dairy for the B12. The ancient Taoists were 100% live food. The early Torah teachings, Genesis 29, again, live food. The inner circle of the Mormons, live food. So the rishis in India, live food. So there's a reason for that, because it helps turn you into a superconductor of the divine. Now, that's the spiritual reason. Well, what about the ecological reasons? Well, gee, you know, a person's vegan saves 1.5 million gallons of water a year. It's a huge swimming pool. You 16 vegans can live on the amount of land of what one meat eater requires. So we have land, we have water. The air also is an issue in terms of when you're eating lower the food chain. Obviously, you're not depending on animal agriculture. What does that mean? Well, to be specific, the research is really showing that maybe industry is contributing 9% of the carbon dioxide, but the animal agriculture is 50%. Some estimates around 50, 54%. Well, then you really got a problem. But it's not just carbon dioxide. It's also ammonia, which is far more warming, and methane, which is far more warming. Basically, methane is about 28 times more warming than carbon dioxide, and nitrogen is about roughly 296 times more warming. So you're not contributing to the global warming gases and so forth. You're minimizing it by being lower in the food chain. The other thing you're doing is when you go vegan, you're supporting organic farming. And what we know is 1 acre of organic farming will pull out 3,700 pounds of carbon dioxide out of the atmosphere. If you go avocados, which we like, 5,200 pounds of carbon dioxide are pulled out of the atmosphere per year. So we're really contributing that way. Now, the other thing is, in a world where there's a lot of people starving, if people on the planet all went vegan, there'd be enough food to feed the population 7 times over. So we have multiple reasons for why we want to do this besides health. We want to think more than health. You know, and of course, animal cruelty. If you're not killing animals, you're obviously avoiding animal cruelty. One of my spiritual teachers, Swami Prakashananda, put it in a beautiful way. He says, when you kill an animal, you create a pain, fear, and misery. And when you eat that animal, their pain, fear, and misery goes into you and comes out as disease. Very eloquent way of putting it. So these are the multiple reasons why I support I'm going to start with vegan, but live food diet. It's just healthier for the planet. It's it allows better regeneration, rejuvenation, ecological protection, and avoiding cruelty, and most important to me, helps you become a superconductor of the divine. These are all good things. So I try to have a holistic viewpoint to this question rather than all about your health.
Absolutely. And I love that, because that's what we really get the most out of when we look at this from a multifactorial or a holistic perspective, right? That there's so much at stake here and so many benefits, again, beyond just our health. So thank you so much for sharing that. Now, you've already mentioned then, yes?
Keep in mind, this is so evident at this point that the World Health Organization and the European Commission have both said it's important that the world population begin moving towards a vegan diet. Now, those are big agencies. They didn't say you should become vegan. That's way too political. But they said people should start considering the movement towards vegan lifestyle. But that's really amazing.
Absolutely, because again, it's showing us the change that is possible and that is taking place as we speak.
And has to take place for the survival of the planet.
Yes, absolutely. And so a plant-based, full plant-based approach or a vegan approach is, of course, one of the core foundations. And you've also mentioned, and there's that emphasis in all of your work and teaching from, again, all those multifactorial levels. You mentioned the live food difference, right? And the emphasis on raw foods. Now, for many people still, because we are so extremely conditioned to cook our food or food, you know, process our food in so many different ways with or without heat, but still, it's often I find hard for them to grasp, like, you know, why is it so important? And, you know, I can't seem to give up my cooked food. And one of the most powerful aspects I think of this is when you talk about in your books and work about just the simple aspect of bioavailability. Can you tell us a little bit about what happens to food that does undergo heat processing and where bioavailability comes in, especially when it comes to nutrients, whether it's the macronutrients like protein or micronutrients like vitamins and such?
Great question. So the Max Planck Institute in Germany said that when you cook your food, you lose 50% of the bioavailability of protein. That's a big deal. When you cook food, you lose 60 to 70% of the vitamins and minerals. And you lose 95 to 100% of the phytonutrients. So that's big losses. What also goes on in this picture is if we begin to see that the food we take in, and obviously the micronutrients, the phytonutrients, and the macronutrients actually affect gene regulations. And that's what I meant by the mTOR pathway with the protein between 35 and 70. It upgrades your gene regulations so that you have optimal longevity and optimum cancer prevention. Okay, but there's more to that. But the point is, you want what we eat affects the epigenetic program, which affects our gene, literally hardcore hard drive regulation. So by what we eat, if we're getting the vital nutrients and so forth, we're actually positively affecting our genes. We are meant to eat food that's going to upgrade our gene function. And that's good. Now, the second thing implied in this is if you're eating live food, you can eat half as much or a third as much. And what we did, Dr. Spindler in 2001 found that with rats, when he fed them 40% less, there was a 400% increase in the anti-aging genes being turned on, the anti-cancer genes, the anti-inflammatory genes, and the antioxidant genes. So the less we eat, in a sense, the more, the better genetic upgrade we're getting. Okay, and inflammation is a big deal because inflammation is the driving force behind all the chronic diseases. So these are all, like, you know, basic things. But now I want to throw in another thing, or more than another thing. I never just have one thing. It's just I like the word unbroken wholeness. And when we have whole, uncooked, raw food, there's an unbroken wholeness. In other words, the pattern of the way God designed it remains intact. And it in itself has a total picture that way. So that's really important. The second thing is Dr. Popp from Germany, and he's still alive, you know, studied food and frequencies and so forth, and he found that people who are eating junk food were giving off about 1,000 biophotons. A person eating cooked organic food is 23,000. A newborn baby is 43,000. Live fooder, 83,000. And if you use live food and certain Chinese herbs, up to 114,000. And that's a huge difference. In other words, it's 83 times more potent and life-giving. Another insight into that is that, at least the theory is that we live in a cosmic biophoton energy cloud, okay? And so when we have more biophoton energies taken into ourselves, we are more able to resonate with the cosmos, the biophoton cosmic cloud. That's why a lot of people in our study, one of my master's students, because as you mentioned, Dr. Cousens' School of Holistic Wellness, actually did an interview with 525 people. Basically, what they found is there was an 87% increase in spiritual interest, creative interest, intellectual kind of interest. People's minds got turned on. And I think that's part of the process of increased biophoton energy. So there are many, many potent, really good things that come from eating this way.
Excellent to hear. And so we've got that foundation of plant foods, at least 80% of that being live food. And of course, we want to pay attention to the quality of our food. And you briefly mentioned the importance of organic. And today we know there's a lot of things happening with regards to genetically modified foods, etc. Can you share a little bit more about why, whenever possible, at all costs, we really should be making organic choices or organic food a priority?
So I'm going to actually start with what we do here at the Tree of Life Foundation Gardens in Patagonia, Arizona. We do veganic farming. Why do we do that? That means no blood meal, bone meal, or manure. Why do we do that? Because animals are often given GMO food. So then that gets transferred for the bone meal, blood meal, and manure. So we just eliminate that major avenue for genetically engineered food to be in our diet, or bacteria that affects us. So that's key. So it's not just organic, but I'm going to say veganic if we want to eliminate the scourge and the medical problems with GMO food. So that's one thing. Now, organic, there's a significant amount of research. It basically shows, and it's going to vary, okay? But when I add up all the studies and people have done it's about 25% more nutrient. And it's significantly more antioxidant, very much higher in the antioxidant. You know, I can't remember exactly what it is, but it's about 100% more antioxidants. And so we're getting a whole lot more nutrition, in particular when we go organic. So that's one level of it. There's another level. There was a study done by the University of Arizona Medical School, and they studied a village in Mexico. And everything was the same, except they looked at the kids who lived in the valley and the kids who lived in the foothills. Pesticides and herbicides go downhill. So what they found is that the kids living in the valley had significant dyslexia, behavior problems. They couldn't even draw a picture. You know, these are 4 and 5 year olds. Significant deficits and kind of across the board in mental functioning. And all the difference was is those kids had more pesticides and herbicides. Now, the average child in the United States is born with 287 toxins in its umbilical cord. It's a lot. 180 of them are carcinogens, and 217 are neurotoxins. So it's these neurotoxins that are obviously affecting the mental state. What we find, and it's not like it's foolproof, but when parents give their kids organic food, they're going to have 1/4 to 1/6 the pesticides and herbicides in their blood. That is going to immediately going to enhance their mental functioning. They did a study in a high school in Wisconsin. Okay, and they simply gave them an organic meal at lunch. Their academic scores went up and their athletic scores went up, and their behaviors were significantly more functional. What I meant is after a while, they took the police out of the schools. Most schools in America need, at the high school need police monitor. They didn't need it anymore because kids' minds were working at a much more refined level, and their their consciousness was working better, but they weren't hyperactive and confused and so forth. So this is in Atherton, Wisconsin. So what I'm saying is going organic really improves your mental state, your physical state, and I'm going to say your ability to reproduce in the big picture. So there's huge advantages to going organic that are very much long-term advantages.
Yeah, and it's so good to hear this because, again, you know, if we add up all the benefits that you've mentioned so far, that, again, touching on the multifactorial aspects of veganic foods and live foods and then organic foods, and each one of these, you know, increases the nutrient density and increases the benefits, not just for our physical health and weight, but mental health, emotional health, spiritual health, all these things that still too often I find get missed, especially in our society, which is so reductionist based that, you know, it's simply all about calories and the magical food that should be the superfood of the day, rather than looking at the big picture of what is happening with our kids in school, what is happening with our energy levels or mental clarity, behavior, emotional health as adults, etc. So if parents are listening to this, I know you touched upon this a little bit in our previous episode on conscious parenting, but again, such an important message that I think would benefit from being reemphasized. Is it completely okay, especially for those parents who might be a little bit apprehensive, to raise a child right from birth on such a foundation of foods?
I'm going to ask it a different way. Is it okay to be giving your kids meat? Is it okay? Is it safe to give your kids meat, fish, chicken, and dairy? That's actually the question that needs to be asked. People aren't asking that question. They're asking it from a defensive vegan position. What I'm going to tell you is when they did studies, you know, with vegan mothers, their kids being born were with height and weight were in the upper 25%. When they continued the study for 4 years, the kids that were organic and veganic were in the upper third, and some were in the upper 12%. So we know that they do better. But there's more to it, because we know that long-term eating of meat, fish, chicken, and dairy actually decreases your lifespan. We know that, depending on the study, vegans live about 7 years longer. Vegan men live 4.2 years longer, another study, and vegan women 3.4 years longer. I don't know why there's a difference. But the point I'm making is the research shows that with children, when they are given the proper diet and format, they're going to continue that with age. And so you're going to increase their not only just their health and the health of the planet, but actually their longevity. Because they already have that program by the time they're 8 years old. So there's many, many advantages to approach it the way I'm talking about in terms of that. And also, initially kids, it's not as individualized, but by 8 to 12, then they start to individualize into their genetic constitutions. So it's really important to go organic in this big picture as part of a total lifestyle, organic, veganic.
Yeah.
And it's a long-term thing, and you're supporting kids for less chronic disease, less cancer, less heart disease, less diabetes, you know, and at the same time, you're avoiding animal cruelty and you're uplifting the whole ecology of the planet. It's a win-win-win-win, and they live longer.
Absolutely. And so if someone is wondering, if they're listening, and from the beginning you've shared that, you know, there is that aspect of following our personal constitution, would it be as simple then if people try to understand simply listening to our body that, maybe I need more fat, maybe I need a higher protein composition, or is there something more special, that some kind of genetic testing that we would have to undergo?
So the full range of your question is true. We find, I have certain interviews in my book, Conscious Eating, and in the Rainbow Green Live Food Cuisine, there's the 30 questions. And it gives you a pretty good sense of the pattern. So you know roughly where to start, and then you have to fine tune it. The issue that's important is people, if they just depend on their minds, remember we have all these programs. Right, so we can't think as clearly. So it's better to do the questionnaire. You can get genetic testing, but it's fairly expensive, and it's not a mass thing. But filling out, 30 questions in Rainbow Green Light Food Cuisine or in Conscious Eating, that's easy. And then, if you're a person that tends to need more protein or a person that tends to need less protein and, higher complex carbohydrate dense. So you can sort that out, and then you have more starting places. And then by trial and error, you refine it. How do you know? You should eat a diet that sustains your energy for 4 or 6 hours, okay? You feel good while you're eating, and you feel good after in that sustainable way. And those are really simple ways of really assessing it.
Excellent to hear. And of course, keeping our health and maintaining and preventing is one of the many benefits of all sides of what you've been sharing. But what if anyone is joining us who may already be afflicted with something like diabetes type 2 or cancer or any part of heart disease or any other condition, really? What hope, what some of the examples, especially with your work on reversing diabetes, can you share when it comes to the power of this way of eating?
Well, I have the details more specifically with the diabetes. So type 2 diabetics, insulin dependent, within 3 weeks, 24% are diabetes free. That means their blood sugar is less than 100 and they're not on any insulin or any other medication. 61% who are non-insulin dependent are healed again in 3 weeks. And that's pretty fast. All over the world, I was just speaking to a bunch of medical students and residents just before I talked to you. All over the world, you're taught, well, you can manage it, but you can't cure it. But the truth is you can, and diet is the primary way, and herbs are secondary with that. So it's all like right there. Heart disease, again, you can prevent it. Cancer, there's a lot of research shows that organic, veganic, live food diet is the most potent diet for reversing that because, again, you're turning on the healthy genes, you're eating less. There's more to the cancer than just diet, but in many cases, that really works for people, like 40% of the cases. That's really good. So across the board, you have that as a treatment thing. So that's what I recommend. It takes we have this 21-day program at the Tree of Life for diabetes and in general, a life's transition program because it saves your life, it saves your brain, it increases every level of quality of life. So that's a good thing in general. This is really interesting, but about 50% of the people come to the Tree of Life here in Patagonia, Arizona, are still eating meat. And they're saying, well, I know I got to do better than that. So when they do the program, just our 21-day program, the vast majority, I won't say 100%, but the vast majority in the 90s have then made a stable, sustained shift to organic, veganic way of life. They just need a push. And what we offer is this surround around experience from organic, veganic farming to 100% live food, vegan, cuisine. And you get used to it and actually you begin to really like it. So we support people in making that transition. I think we have to think about ourselves vegans as a minority, and that's fine. And live fooders more of a minority, but more and more people are seeing the benefits. And so what we've designed here is a way of moving from that meat eating, meat, fish, chicken, dairy, into this high powered, high health, high spiritual. Because there's another piece. A lot of people who have finished the program here say, I've reconnected with my soul. That's of great value. So I see the healing being not just physical, but it's a much deeper, I've reconnected with my soul. That's a big deal. And we've had people from 126 countries come here. So that's a lot of people. And we're bringing that live food vegan message seriously to the world.
Yes. And again, so many different programs that you offer via the Tree of Life. I mean, for anybody who may want the more intensive 21 days, but also shorter, you know, fasting, detox programs. And the most important is, again, support, because I find that when people are shown how easy this can be, how beautiful, how healthy, how healing, that's when it tends to stick and be long-term and sustainable. So fantastic that all this resources and support is there. But of course, sometimes too along the way, it helps to know, is there anything that we should be aware of? For example, some other support that we should have nutritionally. And of course, in the veganic, organic, and live food communities, two of the biggest questions seem to always revolve around B12 and omega-3 fatty acids. Can you speak a little bit about these and how or what is the best way to approach them?
First, let go of the I'm a vegan inferiority complex and I'm not getting enough. What it turns out is, for iodine, an example, about literally 95% of everybody in America, so that's your meat eaters or not, are iodine deficient. 80%, again, everybody, are deficient in magnesium. At the lowest level of 200 nanograms, 40% of meat eaters and 80% of vegans are deficient. We go to 400 to 450 nanograms, which is a healthy amount of B12 in your blood, and you're looking about 80% of meat eaters and maybe 90% of vegans. So meat eaters are also deficient in the B12. Okay, that's a big deal. Okay, so everybody needs to be some level of B12 supplement, but really people need B3, B6, and B12 as in folic acid. It seems a lot of people are deficient in all of those. So that's an important kind of piece of that discussion. Vitamin D, 85% of the public is deficient. That's a big one because vitamin D affects literally 10% of our gene pool. So every diabetic I think comes in is deficient in vitamin D. So these are all things that everyone needs. Vitamin A, same thing. Most of the population is deficient in vitamin A. Most of the public, well, humans don't make vitamin C, so you do need a supplement there. In 1936, the American Congress agreed that 99% of the American public is deficient in minerals. So really, everybody's got some levels of deficiency. So if we let go of our vegan inferiority complex, get everybody's really deficient. And in fact, I'll put it this way, it's better to have the attitude that I should take some supplements than think I'm eating meat and I don't need anything when you're also almost equally deficient or perhaps more deficient in other ways. So everybody needs, in this world with our depleted soils, it's everybody's deficient one way or another.
So we have to, again, take into consideration a smart approach that is, you know, beyond the conditioning that, again, so often is pushed in our society. And we know, too, that any processed food diets, whether they're meat or plant-based, all of this is really not giving us enough. And so I'm glad to hear that you're, you know, trying to show people that it is really across the board. We have to pay attention to all the nutrients and whether we ourselves are, you know, and how we're doing in those areas.
You asked about omega-3s, too. And the research shows in a pregnant woman, more than 90%, again, this is across the board, are deficient in long-chain omega-3s. So again, same answer.
Right. Now, actually, with the omega-3, of course, again, the conditioning is always, oh, fish oils, but that's not the route we want to take. If people are wondering, okay, what do I do then? What would you recommend?
Well, where do fish get their long-chain omega-3s? They get it from yellow algae. So we use extract of the yellow algae. Again, almost everybody's deficient in long-chain omega-3s. So we get it from the yellow algae direct, the long-chain, but we also, there's some other tricks that really work. Flaxseed, hemp seed, chia seed, and walnuts, they all are higher in short-chain omega-3s. And when you add coconut oil, okay, let's say you do 3 tablespoons of flaxseed ground and 1 tablespoon of coconut oil, you're doubling your rate of absorption. So we usually observe 1-3 conversion rate to long chain is 1-3%. We jump it to 6-10%, which is very significant.
Yeah. So thank you so much for sharing all that regarding the nutrition. And again, one of the biggest benefits that also needs to be emphasized here is that, just like we shared at the beginning, this is about so much more than healthy eating. This is about, as you shared, connecting with the soul, about, you know, looking at ourselves from that broader perspective, from our spiritual, not just physical nature, and how all of these food choices, lifestyle choices, impact us and positively benefit us. Is there anything else that you would specifically like to mention, aside from healthy eating, how other lifestyle factors or choices that you are especially passionate about and have also seen to be effective that really benefit us on that physical, spiritual, mental, emotional level?
So I love your questions, okay? If we kind of take the overview that the key to doing this is loving yourself enough to want to heal yourself, okay? So what we find is, like, in people come for a detox or whatever their experience is, they start to reconnect to their soul. They start to love themselves enough to heal themselves. And then they have a much more powerful motivation. So motivation to live this way, to get into it, is actually a big deal. It's really a big deal. And that's part of why we keep it so focused. Okay, that's one thing. The other thing is people who meditate and have been meditating for at least 7.5 years have a physiology that's 15 years younger. So I stress the meditation. I also suggest and support service and charity. Okay. So we got our live food cuisine, at least 80%. We want to do certain things like breathing exercises and Tai Chi and Qigong to build the prana, which expands consciousness, service and charity. Working with some level of spiritual teacher, understanding the scriptures so you can actually move in a good way and not get lost along the way. Meditating, chanting, repeating the name of God, prayer, they all have been shown to increase your healing energies. Okay. And I want to say also proper exercise, aerobic and stretching, because you want both the flexibility and you want to have the cardio, and all that happens. It's not that hard. If you walk fast 4 times a week, that's good enough. I mean, none of this is complex. But we also know, for example, that people who exercise, it's 80% effective in ameliorating depression. Just as an example. So you get the sense of well-being. So I really recommend exercise, moderate exercise, maybe 4 times a week. These are all really good things. And I'm going to talk about love, because we know that people in relationships also live longer. So love is actually a big factor in this, not just a couple relationship, or what I call a sacred relationship, but a network. Both have been shown in longevity studies to enhance your longevity. So these are all things that kind of go together, you know, and ultimately then you're more motivated to connect to your soul and love yourself enough to heal yourself. And that's the way to proceed. One step at a time. Not everybody can do everything at once. Fine. One successful step at a time is key to it. So those are my general advices.
Excellent. Love them and resonate with them all so very much as well. And so thank you so very much again. It's always such a pleasure to have you on and have you share in your beautiful and, again, such well-rounded approach to all aspects of our health and well-being. And for anyone who would like to learn more about you, read up on so much of the information that is shared via your website, and of course learn more about the Tree of Life and some of the different programs that are available, whether it's for health and healing, whether it's for continuing education, perhaps of course some of the master's programs, etc., that you have, the best place to start is treeoflifecenterus.com. And of course, lots of wonderful information.
Or
is,
yep, just simply drcousins.com.
Or drcousins.com. Facebook and Twitter, also lots of things shared there as well. And so, Dr. Cousens, thank you so very much again for being here with us today.
Great. Thank you. And blessings to you. And thank you for your good work.
My pleasure. And again, thank you. And thank you, everyone, for joining us. If you have any questions, comments, or feedback, please feel free to share in the comments section below. Thank you, and till next time.